Hi, good evening. I'm Dr. Barrow. I'm here to welcome you to tonight's event with Pennsylvanians for the Modern Court. I'm going to tell you a little bit about that and then introduce our keynote speaker. So Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts is the only statewide nonprofit, nonpartisan organization dedicated to ensuring that all Pennsylvanians can come to the court with confidence that they will be heard by a qualified, fair, and impartial judge. They advocate for the racial, geographic, and experiential diversity in the state's judiciary and its jury pools. And they firmly believe that appellate judges should be selected through a merit-based system rather than through partisan political elections. And near and dear to my heart, a key tenet of PMC's work is to engage and educate fellow citizens, especially in Pennsylvania, in a better understanding of our courts and how they function. Our speaker tonight, Maida Milone, has practiced law and managed for-profit organizations for nearly 20 years, spending most of that time in the pharmaceutical industry, where she served as general counsel of the DuPont Merck Pharmaceutical Company, before turning her attention full-time to nonprofit organizations. Maida joined Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts from the Devereux Foundation, where she served as Vice President of Business Development and Strategic Planning. Maida is active in many civic and philanthropic organizations, including the Wistar Institute, Women's Health Leadership Council of the University of Pennsylvania Health System, and as a steward with Child's World of America. Maida holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in philosophy and a Juris Doctorate from the University of Pennsylvania. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to Maida Milone, President and CEO of Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts.
That's lovely. Good evening, everyone. I'm so pleased to be here. It's really wonderful to look out and see all of you anxious to learn about the judicial system in Pennsylvania, which is something near and dear to my heart. I'm going to try to do my slides myself, but I might hand this off to someone. So you just heard a little bit of a synopsis of our mission and the goals of the organization. And it is true that this is what we have been committed to doing for 30 years, remain as passionate about it now as we were 30 years ago, and find that as the political tides change and our society changes, our goals remain as important as they were 30 years ago, and sometimes even more important than they were then. Our organization was formed 3 decades ago when the then Governor Casey of Pennsylvania decided that we needed a commission to figure out why the court system in Pennsylvania was held in such low esteem by the citizens of the Commonwealth. And so Governor Casey asked then Judge Phyllis Beck, who is one of our founders, to chair a commission of noted lawyers and judges to consider exactly why the court system was not held in high esteem. So the commission worked for over a year and developed a report and recommendations. They decided that they didn't want that report and recommendations to gather dust on a shelf, and we all know, right, we receive those things in the mail, we put them on the shelf, we promise ourselves we're going to read them at some point, and then we don't, and nothing happens. So they decided to form Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts with the mission of trying to bring a merit selection appointment system to Pennsylvania in lieu of our partisan elections of judges, as well as trying to make some changes to the judicial discipline system, which we have been able to accomplish, and a number of other recommendations. But that has sort of been the Bible for the organization over these 30 years. And, well, I'm happy to say that we are making progress on our merit selection efforts, particularly in this current legislative session. And I hope we will do even better and achieve success in the next one. It has been a 30-year process to get us to this point. So the reason that we do a court basics presentation is that a lot of people don't really understand the judicial system in the Commonwealth. And there's no reason to be embarrassed about that. I confess, I am a lawyer, and I practiced law for a long time before going into the nonprofit world. And when I joined Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts, I had to refresh my recollection of exactly how the court system is organized in Pennsylvania and exactly what the role is of each court. So please, this is a basics, you know, this is the court, you know, the court system for everybody. If there are things that you know, forgive me, but I think it's always good to have a refresher course. So, there are two major types of cases that come before the courts. We have civil cases and criminal cases. I think more often people hear about criminal cases. They tend to get a lot more press and we watch them on Law and Order, and so that's typically what we think of when we think of litigation or a lawsuit. But in fact, in civil cases, that's where someone, an individual, is seeking redress for some injury and seeking either money damages or an injunction, that is forcing someone to do something that they promised to do but aren't currently doing. And the standard by which you need to prove your case is a preponderance of the evidence. Now, I know we're all accustomed to thinking on the criminal side beyond a reasonable doubt, but the standard is different on the civil side. In criminal cases, that's where we have the state or the federal government, depending on whether you're in state court or federal court, when the government is bringing the case against you as an individual or you as a corporation if there is some crime that's been committed by an organization. And there, they must prove their case beyond a reasonable doubt. And in that case, the result can be either some monetary penalty, but usually incarceration for some period of time. So our civil cases, oftentimes involving commercial matters or a trip and fall, and you're suing the location where you fell, those are our typical civil cases. But on the criminal side, we're all accustomed to thinking about the DA, the prosecutor, and a jury trial. So let's talk a little bit about the structure of the courts. And Tom, I think I'm going to hand this off to you so you can do the slides for me. We love pyramids, right? Pyramids are always the easiest way to remember things. So at the top of the pyramid, you have the Supreme Court, and coming down, you have the intermediate appellate courts, common pleas, and then our lower courts, our minor courts, as we refer to them. And I'm going to pull apart this pyramid and talk to you about each one of the building blocks of this pyramid. So in Philadelphia, we don't have magisterial district courts. It's very unusual. Every other judicial district in Pennsylvania has magisterial district courts, but we don't in Philadelphia. Historical quirk, I guess, we have municipal courts in Philadelphia. But the magisterial district courts around the Commonwealth handle smaller matters, so civil actions that are less than $12,000. So if you fell and you're only seeking $10,000, you'll be in one of the minor courts. You'd be in a magisterial district court. Landlord-tenant matters are handled in magisterial district courts outside of Philadelphia. In Philadelphia, we have a housing court. It's located in the city. It's, you know, in one building. But outside of Philadelphia, there are magisterial district judges scattered throughout the judicial district, and that's where you would go for minor matters, including some preliminary hearings. There are some criminal matters that are handled by the magisterial district judges, and including some bail hearings and some of the minor criminal matters. The more significant criminal matters will be heard in Common Pleas Court. Interesting, though, just recently, our state legislature passed a bill. Magisterial district judges, and I'm going off on a tangent, but I will bring you back. Magisterial district judges run for office, and they have to run every 6 years. Recently, the legislature passed a bill that helps them avoid going out and having a petition signed. They needed to get 100 signatures every time they decide to run for office, and they have to go out and meet and greet people and get 100 signatures on their petition to run. Recently, the legislature passed a law that eliminates sitting magisterial district judges' need to go out and do that. The thinking is, the magisterial district judges live in the community. They handle all kinds of matters, including criminal matters. And for them, sometimes going out and knocking on people's doors and trying to get their petition signed, they might very well come upon someone against whom they have ruled unfavorably or someone for whom they've set bail, and so it can be a very awkward and difficult situation for them. So, given that they only need to get 100 signatures, it would be a different story if they needed 50,000 signatures, but 100 signatures, any sitting magistrate who is running again to be an MDJ does not have to go out and get the 100 signatures. And I think, you know, when you understand this, when you see what it is they handle, then that law can, you know, make some sense to you. Yes, it looks like, do you have a question? Well, I mean, technically they probably could, but I think officially they are supposed to go out and secure the signatures themselves. There was a question about sending a surrogate. I'm not sure if everyone can hear, so if you have a question, I'm happy to answer them as we go along, or we can wait and do a Q&A at the end. So in Philadelphia, as I said, we have municipal court. We don't have a magisterial district court. And as you can see, they handle criminal offenses with terms of 5 years or less. So these are the lesser criminal offenses. There are three divisions of municipal court. We have the civil court, criminal court, and traffic court. Now, again, interestingly, we used to have a separate traffic court in Philadelphia. Again, another one of these funny quirks of history. But recently, we passed, you all voted, and we passed a constitutional amendment to the state constitution to eliminate traffic court. And why did we do that? It was rife with corruption. Many of the judges were entering guilty pleas and resigning from their positions, and so the decision was made that it makes more sense to integrate it into our municipal court so that it's really a part of and functions as a part of our judicial system rather than as a separate entity with its own culture and rules and regulations. So the courts of common pleas, these are the ones I think that, you know, most of the time we think about. These are our trial courts, and they handle the majority of cases in the Commonwealth. So if you've got a significant criminal matter, if you have a civil case that's in excess of, you know, $12,000, and that covers a, you know, many, many lawsuits, you'll end up in common pleas court. And they hold jury trials, and they are very, very active and very busy courts. So these are our common pleas courts. As we make our way up the pyramid, we go to our intermediate appellate courts. So you're not happy with how things were resolved and at the trial level in the common pleas court, and you want to appeal. Now, there's not always an appealable issue, and we won't get too technical into, you know, what can be appealed and what can't be appealed, but more often than not, there are grounds for appeal, and then you move generally to Superior Court. Superior Court handles most of these appeals, and it is the busiest, they have the busiest docket of any intermediate appellate court in the United States. We have a very, very active court system in Pennsylvania, and our Superior Court judges are wildly busy. They sit generally in panels of three judges. They sit around the Commonwealth. So we hear cases in Philadelphia and Pittsburgh and Harrisburg. And sometimes they go to some of the other judicial districts to hear cases. And, you know, again, I think it's sort of what you would imagine. When you appeal a case, you're not having what they call a trial de novo. It's not a new trial. You are just raising the issues that you think were not considered properly below. So you are speaking, your counsel, or you, if you're pro se, that is representing yourself, will be speaking to the three-judge panel, explaining the law as applied to the facts as they were determined below. Generally, you cannot introduce new facts on appeal. There might be a circumstance where you could do that, but generally, the judges work from the record below, from the trial court record, and they're deciding whether or not there was a real error of law or application of law to facts. So it's very different from our conception of trial court. Although I'm sure on Law and Order you've seen when they have to go to the New York, you know, Supreme Court, which is their intermediate appellate court, to make a case before a panel of judges. Now, we have in Pennsylvania a Commonwealth Court. This is a second intermediate appellate court, which most states don't have. But we carved out this special intermediate appellate court to handle matters involving the government. You know, suits that are brought against the government or an appeal from a state agency decision, those are handled by the Commonwealth Court. And then finally, we move to the Supreme Court. Our Pennsylvania Supreme Court is the highest court in the Commonwealth. It has great discretion in deciding what cases it will hear and what cases it will not hear. So most people sort of think, well, you go to the intermediate appellate court, and then from there you go to the Supreme Court. But generally, the intermediate appellate courts are the courts of sort of last resort for most people, because absent a few cases, and that is death penalty cases, criminal cases, cases involving the state constitution, you know, cases where the Supreme Court must take jurisdiction. Otherwise, it has great discretion to decide when it's going to take a case and when it's not going to take a case. And so sometimes it will take a case if a number of Superior Court panels have made, you know, decisions on a particular interpretation of a law and there's some confusion between the decisions that have been made by the panels, then there's a reason for the Supreme Court to take it up. Or there may be an issue that they just feel is of great import to the citizens of Pennsylvania, and then they take it up. And there may be reasons that they have for not taking up certain cases. So I think the important fact to take away here is if you appeal and you go to Superior Court, that might well be the final decision in your case. You might not have an opportunity to go to the Supreme Court. Now, just a quick comparison between federal court and state court. We, as an organization, are concerned with the courts of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, but we have our sister federal courts, and the structure of the federal courts is very similar to the structure of our state courts. We've got the U.S. Supreme Court, we have our courts, U.S. Courts of Appeal, and we have the district courts, which are the trial courts that hear the bulk of the criminal and civil matters. So for our federal court, there are three districts in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Not surprisingly, our western, our middle, and our eastern. These three districts are very important to Pennsylvanians for modern courts, in part because as we work to try to bring merit selection of appellate judges to Pennsylvania, in that process, there has been a lot of debate and dialogue about whether or not our Citizens Nominating Commission, this commission of citizens that we hope we will have determining who the candidates should be for recommendation to the governor. The question is, you know, where should they be just choosing candidates from across Pennsylvania? Just looking at merit and choosing candidates from across Pennsylvania. And originally, Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts really supported that and said, yes, they should be free to choose, you know, anyone who applies, if they're all from, you know, Pittsburgh, if they're all from Philadelphia, if they're all from Harrisburg, wherever they're from, they should be able to choose these candidates. But then, you know, we listened very intently to a number of legislators from the middle of the state who said, thus far, you know, those sort of big law firm lawyers from Philadelphia and from Pittsburgh tend to make it on to the appellate courts and then onto the Supreme Court. And we really want to feel that qualified candidates from the middle of the state, who might not be as well known, might not have worked for one of the major law firms on the west or the eastern side of the state, we want to make sure that they have an opportunity to become judges. And so we compromised. And that is a word that I love. And I wish that we did more of in our society at the moment. We heard what they had to say. We said, you know, there is some sense in that. And we live with three districts with our federal court, right? We have our judges in the western, the middle, and the eastern district of Pennsylvania. So there isn't any reason why we can't have judges selected from western, middle, and eastern Pennsylvania to serve on our appellate courts. So the bill, our bill that is now pending before the state legislature, House Bill 111, which I hope you will all support, was amended in order to include the fact that the Citizens Nominating Commission will select a certain number from the West, from the East, and from the middle part of the state. So moving on, let's talk about judicial elections. I've sort of veered off into this discussion of partisan judicial elections versus merit selection of our judges. And this is a topic that is really hot in the United States today. If you read anything about, you know, New Mexico, North Carolina, West Virginia, you know, all of the controversy is about judges and how judges are selected and the impact of that on perceptions of the judges' rulings and ability to be independent. In Pennsylvania, we had a merit selection system very early on in the history of the Commonwealth, and it wasn't managed as well, perhaps, as it could have been. And so then there was a move to partisan elections. And we made that shift, and we have been electing our judges through these partisan elections for quite a long time. The system, as it stands now, you can see our judges on the Supreme Court, they have a 10-year term, and after that 10-year term, they don't run again in a partisan election. They don't have competition. They are just up for retention, which is when you all go to vote and you get into your, into the voting booth and you say, oh my God, I've never heard of these people. Who are they and what am I supposed to decide? And then you say, oh yes, yes or no, retain them or don't retain them. Oftentimes, we, and I include myself in this, have no idea who the people are or what kind of job they've been doing over the past 10 years, but nonetheless, we are required to vote for them. Our intermediate appellate courts, it's the same thing, 10-year terms, then retention, same for the Court of Common Pleas. I mentioned to you, really the only difference is for our magisterial district judges. They don't run for retention, they have to run again in a partisan election. So they will have a competitor and they will be vying for people's votes against their competitor. So it's a funny system, sort of how it's been developed this way, but as it stands now, Pennsylvania is one of only six remaining states in the United States that has partisan elections for all levels of judges. So we are by far in the minority, continuing to do that. Most other states have some combination of election and merit selection. Most of the time, or more often than not, those elections are nonpartisan. So the person, you are not voting for, you know, John Smith, Democrat, or, you know, Nancy Franklin, Republican. It's just John Smith and Nancy Franklin. So you're not supposed to be basing your decision on their party affiliation, but on what you know about them as upstanding jurists or qualified lawyers or, you know, active community members. So who can become a judge or justice? Well, you have to go to law school. That's a whole nother story. We could talk about that another night, but you have to be a resident in Pennsylvania, and other than that, there aren't a lot of requirements to be a judge or a justice. Now, if you ask Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts, when it's election time, what are the qualifications? You can come to our website, www.pmconline.org, and you'll find a wealth of information about the candidates. And included in that information is, if this person is going to be an appellate judge, you know, have they practiced in appellate court? You know, were they trial lawyers? or were they a trial judge? What experience do they have in order to do that? You know, how were they educated? Obviously, they went to law school, but did they do any further education? Do they participate in their community? Do they understand the needs of people in their communities? How sensitive are they? And finally, and I think most important, do they have the temperament to be a judge? Because what we're looking for in a judge is someone who is patient, someone who listens well, someone who is able to apply the law to the facts before him, her, they, and not someone who comes predisposed to making decisions without analyzing the case before them, and someone who tends to have a very emotional reaction to what's going on in the courtroom. You want someone who's calm and patient and balanced and fair and empathetic. So those are the things that you can consider when you're deciding whether to vote for someone or not. And we will have elections in 2019. Even if we're successful with our merit selection legislation, you will continue to vote for magisterial district judges, municipal court judges, and common pleas court judges. You'll also continue to vote in retention elections, right? So there's still information that you'll need to gather going forward, and there are lots of sources of good information for you, but you can find all of them on our website if you ever have any questions. So moving on, now we're going to make a little bit of a shift. We've been talking about the structure of the courts, about the judges and how we select them and what they should be like, and then of course their juries. Now, not every trial has a jury, but the majority of them do. There are bench trials where the parties agree that the judge is going to make the decision in the case and there will not be a jury, but generally there are juries. And I, just an aside, I clerked when I finished law school. I clerked for the most wonderful man in the world, Judge John Gary in the District of New Jersey, who was brilliant, never took himself too seriously, phenomenal sense of humor, and had a deep and abiding confidence in the jury system. And like a lot of people, when I first got there, I thought, oh God, you know, some of these trials, they're so complicated, especially on the civil side, you know, complex bankruptcy, you know, like commercial litigation matters that went on for weeks and were very, very complicated. And so you would think, oh my God, you know, we've just picked these people and they don't know anything about this, and we're testing their patience, trying to keep them alert all day, listening to all of this testimony. And at the end of the day, the questions that would come to us from the jury room, when they can ask the judge questions, I was always impressed by how they really got to the heart of the issue. They clearly listened and understood what was going on, and ask questions that I would be asking if I were sitting on the jury. And so I came to have much more confidence in the jury system than I might otherwise have had. And I think it's so important, if I can encourage each and every one of you, if you are called to serve on a jury, please do it. I know there are lots of reasons not to, and we're often busy, and we have work pressures and school pressures, and there are all sorts of reasons not to do it. But we really do need juries of our peers. And if we don't serve on juries, then our peers are not going to have our insight and our experiences and our empathy. And so it's very important to serve on juries, and I want to encourage you to do that. So, juries, I have to say, a lot of people do not serve on juries, so the courts are often sort of scrambling to get enough people to come, and you really are required to serve on the jury. You either have to be excused or you have to serve, and someone will be looking for you potentially if you don't serve and you don't have an excuse, so that's also a good reason to serve on the jury. People who are involved in the armed forces, active service, obviously, are excused. Families of criminal homicide victims are often excused from serving on the juries of criminal cases. And undue hardship. It's interesting. I have been called many times. I always go. And I'm always excused. And I think it's because I'm a lawyer. I clerked for a judge. Now I'm involved with a judicial organization, so no one wants me, but I'm sure they will want you, so please participate. So now we're going to talk a little bit about self-representation. Not going to talk to you a lot about lawyers in the courtroom, but talking about many of us who represent ourselves when we go to court, and I'm sure there are some of you, in addition to me, who have self-represented on a traffic violation, an alleged traffic violation. When you've gone to court, you've represented yourself. You know, it's relatively easy to do when you are in the traffic division. It's much harder, much more complicated to do if your home is at stake and you're trying to represent yourself in an eviction matter. You know, if... on the criminal side, obviously, given the Supreme Court decision in Gideon, people who cannot afford to be represented are given representation by the state. But on the civil side, there is no civil Gideon, at least not yet. And so if it's a civil matter, you're there on your own if you can't afford to have an attorney. And part of the reason that PMC has started to do this kind of programming is so that people who have to self-represent will have a better understanding of the court system, where they are, what court they're in, and how it sort of fits in the whole scheme of things, if they'll be able to appeal the decision. And we also do programming on specific courts to help people navigate their way through housing court, family court, criminal court. So we can drill down and talk to you at another time about specific courts in the Pennsylvania court system. So there is an e-filing system now. And of course, we can't assume that everybody has a computer, access to a computer, but this is the way that it's done now. So you need to go online, find the right form, fill out that form, and you can either do it, you know, online, or there are terminals now in the, you know, courthouses. You can go to the terminals and you can use those to file your action, but that can be intimidating to people. And I don't know how you feel, but I have a heck of a time filling out forms. I always think, but that's not the question they should be asking, or what does that mean? So it's not easy. It's great when there are navigators in the courthouses who can help people fill out their forms and tell them where to go, but we don't have navigators in all of our courthouses. So that's another reason to do educational programming about the court system. As we said, court employees cannot help you. I mean, they can direct you to where the computer is or where the room is, but they can't help you fill out the forms. They're not permitted to give you that kind of advice. And then, of course, you have to serve your complaint on the defendant. If you are the plaintiff and you're filing a civil action against someone, you have to make sure that the defendant gets that complaint in hand. So there are rules about how the complaint is served, and you have to be very careful to read them and follow them to make sure that, you know, service is achieved. This is just, it's very hard to read, but, and it might just be my older eyes, but this is what the e-filing looks like. And we're going to try to blow that up more for our next presentation. But you have to sort of, you know, you walk your way through this form, your name, you know, the nature of your complaint, the person you want to serve with the complaint. And there is a filing fee as well. So, you know, this isn't easy for a lot of people. So, impact. Just to give you a sense of the enormity of the situation, we had, these are the statistics, the most current ones we have, and they're from 2016, nearly 12,000 new criminal cases filed in Philadelphia alone. 35,000 civil cases were docketed. So when I said our Superior Court judges are, their hair's on fire, their hair's on fire. I mean, there just are so many cases that are filed. One thing, this probably is a slightly separate point, but I think everyone wonders, like, why are the courts important? Like, why would I care? Why should I bother finding out about who these judges are and go vote or, you know, decide whether to retain them or not retain them or campaign for them? Like, why does it matter? And oftentimes, it's hard for us to think about why it's important, right? I mean, what decisions are they making that impact your lives? I pulled out three, and this was a year ago. One of them is no longer all that relevant because our school reform commission is no more. But, you know, the first case, DP and BP versus GJP and AP, is a case involving grandparents' rights to grandchildren. And there was a law that said if parents are separated for at least 6 months, grandparents can petition to take custody of their grandchildren for some portion of time. Well, the Supreme Court considered that and struck down that law as unconstitutional. But when I gave this presentation, you know, several months ago, a woman said, yeah, I know all about that because my daughter and her husband are separated and they've been separated for a while and the kids are kind of going back and forth and I really wanted them to be with me. And I said, well, that's why you should care about, you know, the Supreme Court, because they make decisions that impact your life. The second case, Leach, that's Dalen Leach, State Senator Dalen Leach against the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Dalen, there was a law passed by the legislature that municipalities could not impose restrictions, Second Amendment restrictions on, you know, they couldn't have their local gun control laws. And if they did, you know, they'd lose funding. So he challenged that law and it was overturned. So, you know, again, talk about something that has an impact on our day-to-day lives. That's from the Supreme Court of the state of Pennsylvania. So it's important. It's important. So yes, please vote. And I'm glad that everybody, I'm assuming everyone here voted in the past election, and we will have judicial elections in 2019. So we're starting to gear up for them. We have to prepare. We have to get prepared much earlier than you do because folks are going to start campaigning for their judgeships in January for next November's judicial election. So it becomes very important to us early on. But what they will be doing, of course, is they will be fundraising because they can't have television ads and they can't do all the things they need to do to campaign if they don't raise money. And then the question becomes, where does the money come from? And does that have any influence on judicial decisions? I happen to think that we have some of the most amazing, highly ethical, brilliant people on our state court in Pennsylvania. Nonetheless, the fact that they are forced to have their surrogates go out and raise money and go out and campaign can create a perception that those dollars somehow influence their decision making. In most cases, it doesn't. But we really feel that the impression that creates, that process, is really antithetical to everything we think about when we think about judges. As I said, right? Fair, detached, not involved in the hurly-burly of the political landscape, able to be patient and thoughtful and impartial. So you will be voting in 2019, and we will help give you the information that you need to vote well in 2019, but our hope is that soon thereafter, at least, we won't be voting for our appellate court judges. So I hope I haven't bored you. I hope this hasn't gone on too long. I know it's late, it's dim in here, but I hope I was interesting enough to keep you all awake and alert, and I'm happy for any questions that you have. Yes?
So Maida, when you were talking about the formation of the commission, the back commission,
yes.
Could you tell us a little bit about the tawdry details, the Philadelphia, the Roofers Union, the mob, the judges taking cash in some cases? That had a lot to do with the decision, didn't it, to form the commission?
I think so, yes. I mean, we sort of lurch from one crisis to the next in the judiciary, with some quiet, pleasant times in between. But yes, there were a number of scandals at the time that really tarnished the court. As well as recently, you know, in the not very distant past, we had three of our Supreme Court justices step down. One was indicted and two resigned, but over scandals. And as a result of those scandals, Pennsylvanians for Modern Courts issued a report and recommendations on how to improve the judicial discipline system in Pennsylvania. And a number of those recommendations have been adopted. I think the Court of Judicial Discipline and the Judicial Conduct Board were very open to meeting with us and, you know, talking about making some changes, some of which they have made. We continue to press on, trying to have all of those recommendations implemented. But recently, the court imposed continuing judicial education requirements on all of the judges in Pennsylvania, including ethics education. And, you know, that's wonderful. That's a step in the right direction.
Yes. I was struck in listening to you speak a couple of years ago. We supported the screening of a film that ultimately had to be housed in one of the children. There's a number of people who did it, but I'm not going to say that they did well, which is awesome. And at the end, there was a panel discussion, and the people were asking about how to make change, how they could change the trajectory of the decisions regarding the criminal justice system and some of the decisions that they made. And what came out of that discussion was to pay attention to the judges. And they had pointed out that there were many pollsters and people who were out for election. I don't know that it happens during me and myself. I wasn't aware that was something that people had that opportunity to vote on. And I think, as you pointed out, the yay or nay, they don't know what they're very, very infrequently do we hear about a judge's record that they are.
Yes, it's true.
Or long incarceration periods. And that's just not something that's coming out in the PR campaigns.
That's true. And there is information out there, but oftentimes, it comes out over sort of a 10-year period of time while someone's on the bench, and unless it's collated and, presented in a way that helps everyone understand the import of those decisions, it's really tough. I mean, some people say, you want to take the vote away from the people. And that is honestly really the last thing that we certainly want to do. What we want to make sure, though, is that we have the highest caliber, most highly qualified people on the bench, and that when people do go to vote for Common Pleas Court or Magisterial District Court or Municipal Court or for the retention elections, that they have the information they need to make, a thoughtful and reasoned decision about those judges. But it's a great point. Judges have so much influence on our lives, and we don't think about that unless we're caught up in something. If you're caught up in a criminal matter, or if you're going through a divorce, or you have a custody situation, or then you realize what influence a judge and the judicial system can have on your life. But otherwise, we sort of don't think about it most of the time. It's a good point. Any other questions?
Yes.
What's the rational underpinning for calling out certain individuals to be on a jury for the service? You use yourself as an example of being employed. I find that the scientists also seems to be a good idea.
Excluded. So the gentleman's question was about, your professional experiences and why people are often eliminated from juries because of them. I think it depends on the facts of the case. I think there are certain cases where one side will very much want someone who can understand scientific matters. But on the other hand, if the details of the case are so complex, they might just prefer to have people on, who will be weighing the, whether or not a particular witness is believable, looking at the big picture instead of sort of getting down into the nitty-gritty and taking a lot of time with the jury, talking about kind of the scientific facts of the matter as opposed to, the decision that a particular lawyer wants in the case. And I think the same is true sometimes for lawyers. They think, well, you're sitting there as an experienced legal professional. There are certain things that they might want to say or do that you might see through that other people might not see through. And they do have, they do have the right to have people on the jury to help them get the result that they want. That's their job. Their job is to zealously represent their client. And if they want a particular result, and they think that you or I are not going to help them get to that result, they won't want us.
I understand that. I mean, what's, is that independent judicial system?
No, it's not. It's not. I mean, I think really it's just, it's developed as we have moved from being a largely agrarian society into, a society of many professions. Over time, lawyers have become very sensitive to juries. I don't know if you watch the television program Bull, but if you do, you see how carefully, they calibrate the personalities of people on the jury and the expertise of people on the jury. And so sometimes they just don't want us. But it's a very good question. It's not a part of our tradition. It's just, it has really developed over time. Any other questions? Yes.
Would you say in this day and age there's a lack or an excess of amount of candidates that want to be judges compared to, say, 20, 30 years ago?
It's a very good question, and I can't personally opine on that one because I don't know offhand whether there are you know, fewer people or more people who want to run. But it's a great question, and now you have me thinking about this. I think in the last election, judicial election, we had almost all women who were elected to our appellate bench. And that, you know, the connection there being, you know, I think it was a time when people began to feel, for whatever reason, that women would be fair, women would be impartial, women might be more empathetic to them, and so they're voting for more women. So I think now that there are a lot of women on the bench, other women are encouraged to run. So we might be able to parse it a little more finely and say not just more people or less people, but more people of color, you know, more women. It'll be interesting. It's interesting to look at that. And that also brings to mind one other point, and then I will let you go because I know I've had your ear for a long time. We did some research and wrote a piece about a year and a half, 2 years ago, that in a merit selection system, you do find greater diversity on the bench than you do with elective systems. And between partisan and nonpartisan elections, there is less diversity with partisan elections than with nonpartisan elections. So if we're looking for greater diversity on the bench, you know, I think that's another reason to support merit selection over partisan elections. Yes? That's a great question. So we have worked really tirelessly over the 30 years to try to bring greater diversity to juries and to the judicial system through advocacy work, sitting on a lot of committees, doing work, I think, that has helped to diversify our juries. Not as effective, I think, in our judges, in our judicial system, because we have very few people of color in our judiciary, and I see that as a really significant issue in Pennsylvania. Certainly at the appellate level, on the Common Pleas Court, I think doing better than we did before, but not where we need to be. One of the steps, though, that we just took recently, we've started a court watchdog program. And if any of you are interested in volunteering and being court watchdogs for us, we would love it. We joined forces with Philly Bail Fund, which is a nonprofit that's trying to raise dollars for people's cash bail if they can't afford it. And we formed Philly Bail Watch. And we trained nearly, 100 volunteers who went in and watched well over 650 bail hearings, and we just issued a report and recommendations on the bail system in Philadelphia in the First Judicial District, and I will be, along with some other folks, meeting with the First Judicial District and the DA's office next week to talk about those recommendations, because clearly the observation showed cash bail more often than not for people of color. And the system itself doesn't work well. People are not there. They're not present. They're not physically there for their bail hearings. They take place via video conferencing, and often the defendant can't hear anything that's being said, can't consult with counsel. So there's a lot that needs to be done, and I think if we can begin there and tackle that, that will make a big difference if people are, not incarcerated because they can't pay cash bail that's, exorbitant or far beyond their means. Well, thank you all. You've been wonderful. You've been very patient. I hope this was helpful to you, and we'll look forward to meeting with you again soon. Thank you.